Hello, welcome to week 4's first video lecture. In our video lectures last week, we covered how to identify independent and dependent clauses. This week, we'll build on that by learning how to put clauses together. In particular, we'll go over how to use commas when putting together different types of clauses, how to identify a comma splice, and what exactly a run-on sentence looks like. Let's get started. Let's take our first example sentence. Use index cards instead of post-it notes. We have two nouns here, index cards and post-it notes. We also have a verb, which is use. We have kind of two different phrases though, use index cards and instead of post-it notes. The reason we can differentiate these two is because the verb use is implied in the second half. So instead of post-it notes, we might also add the word using in order to complete the thought instead of using post-it notes. That new sentence with the implied second verb would be use index cards instead of using post-it notes. Now that we have our two clauses, we can identify the objects of both of those verbs. In the first case, obviously it's index cards, and then in the latter case, it's post-it notes. This sentence is an example of a new mood that we haven't yet discussed, so I'd like to take a moment just to go over the different types of moods sentences can have. There's three primary moods. We'll learn about a fourth in a few weeks, but it's not important to know now. The ones you should keep in mind are the indicative, the interrogative, and the imperative moods. They're relatively straightforward. The indicative mood indicates something. It says that something is the case. This is the mood that we've been working with for the past few weeks in our video lectures. The second one, the interrogative mood, interrogates someone or something. You know it's interrogative because it's performing some kind of interrogating function. And then the third mood is the imperative mood. Verbs that are in the imperative mood command someone or something to do something. So those are our three moods. Here we have, as I mentioned, a new mood. Whereas we've been working with the indicative mood, we now have the interrogative mood. If you're not sure how to identify which type of mood a verb is in, you can ask yourself, who is the audience of the sentence in question? So in our case, the audience is whoever's reading the sentence, or maybe we're reading in a book or something, one character is saying it to a different character. So if you can identify a specific audience to whom the sentence is being directed, that's a pretty good sign that it's in the imperative mood. And if it's a command, obviously it's an imperative. So let's get back to our sample sentence. Use index cards instead of post-it notes. We have sort of a no subject slash implied subject here. And we have our full clauses, clause number one and clause number two. So clause number one constitutes on its own a complete thought. Use index cards. Therefore, we can say that it's an independent clause. But the second one, instead of using post-it notes, isn't a complete thought. And therefore, we can say it's a dependent clause. Now, I want to make a point here about how to punctuate independent and dependent clauses. So let's invert the sentence structure to see if we can understand anything about how to punctuate dependent and independent clauses. So let's flip it around. Whereas our earlier sentence read, use index cards instead of post-it notes, now we have instead of post-it notes, use index cards. The first one starts with a dependent marker, which suggests to us, obviously, that the phrase is not complete and the thought is not complete. Therefore, it's a dependent clause. We have all of the attendant sections of the clause, right? We have objects, we have verbs, blah, blah, blah. And the second one, there's no dependent marker. You use index cards. It's still the same standalone sentence. The thing that differentiates the first version from the second version, however, is that we have a comma here between the two clauses, which we didn't have in the first version. So this sort of leads us to our first two guidelines, the first of which is if an independent clause is leading in the sentence, you separate the two with a comma. And we can see an example of this, obviously, in the first point of our guidelines. We have a dependent clause if the independent clause leads, if, of course, being the dependent marker word. And then we have a comma here to differentiate the two clauses. And then we have an independent clause separate with a comma. That's a full thought. If you invert them, on the other hand, just as we've done in our example here, and you have the independent clause coming before the dependent clause that attends to it and that follows it, then you don't have to separate it with a comma. You can move straight into your dependent marker word. Let's try a second sentence to round out our guidelines. Here it is. Marcy flushed a baby wipe. The toilet clogged. This is a rather straightforward segment here. We have some nouns, Marcy, and we have a baby wipe, and then also the toilet. We have a verb, which is flushed, and then a second verb, which is clogged. So maybe we have two clauses going on. Let's sort of diagnose this as we go along. Marcy, obviously, is the subject of the first verb, flushed. And you have to ask yourself, what did Marcy flush? Well, she flushed a baby wipe. So the second noun, which is a baby wipe, we can say there's the object of the first verb, flushed. Moving on to our second verb, the toilet is the thing that's clogging, so we can say that the toilet is the subject of the second verb. Now, because we have two different verbs, we, again, need to think about which verb goes with which clause. So if we identify the two different chunks, right, and separate them into clauses, we come up with our first clause, which is Marcy flushed a baby wipe, and then our second clause, which is the toilet clogged. Now, let's take a moment to appreciate the fact that both of these independent clauses are right now being joined by a comma and only a comma. Commas are too weak to hold together two independent clauses, whereas they can join a dependent clause to an independent clause. They're not quite strong enough an adhesive for two independent clauses to stick together. They'll fall apart. Obviously, we have a variety of punctuation choices in order to separate clauses from one another. We have periods, we have colons, semicolons, M dashes, exclamation points, question marks, etc. In this instance, we should probably choose a period. Because they're two different clauses. Again, because commas aren't quite strong enough to hold together two independent clauses. So let's swap in a period here. Obviously, we also have to capitalize the first word then of the new sentence. You'll note that we still have our independent clauses properly arrayed right next to one another, and now they're adequately punctuated, and they can stand on their own. The period, of course, is strong enough to hold these two together. So while we have our first two rules, right, which deal with the comma as something that's strong enough to hold together, again, an independent clause and a dependent clause, it's not quite strong enough to conjoin two independent clauses, which then becomes our third guideline. So let's just review the sentence that we just looked at and swap back in the comma. It's not quite strong enough. If we swap the comma in and we left it as it was in the first version, we would be identifying something called a comma splice. Ideally, you want to avoid this because, again, commas aren't strong enough to conjoin two independent clauses. Now, there's two ways you can avoid a comma splice. The first is by adding a strong punctuation mark, such as a period or an exclamation point or a question mark. The second way is by strengthening the comma by adding a coordinating conjunction. Now, again, commas on their own aren't strong enough to put them together, but coordinating conjunctions, in fact, are very strong, so the combination of the two is adequate. Let's see what that actually looks like, though, in practice. There's a few ways to remember all of the different options you have for coordinating conjunctions. The most common way, I'm sure you've all heard of it, is by remembering the FANBOYS acronym, which lists all of the coordinating conjunctions, which are for, and, nor, but, or, yet, and so. All of these are really useful in transitioning from one step in a logical sequence to another. That's why they're called coordinating conjunctions. They conjoin while at the same time implying some kind of logical coordination. In our case, I like the conjunction so because it connects clause number one to clause number two by suggesting a if-then relationship, a kind of causal relationship. Because Marcy flushed the baby wipe, then the toilet obviously clogged. Let's swap in our coordinating conjunction and conjoin it, if you will, with the comma that we have. So our sentence now reads, Marcy flushed a baby wipe, so the toilet clogged. You'll note again that we have a comma and we have our coordinating conjunction. The comma plus the coordinating conjunction is kind of like a dynamic duo that can join two independent clauses together. So whereas the comma, again, does a dependent and an independent, we can do this dynamic duo to join two independent clauses together. Now, let's consider another variant. Marcy flushed a baby wipe, so the toilet clogged. When you say it out loud, it sounds exactly the same, but you'll note when you're reading that there's no comma, but we still have the coordinating conjunction. Now, coordinating conjunctions are exceptionally strong. Without the comma to sort of tone them down, they constitute what's called a run-on sentence. Run-on sentences aren't necessarily super long, they just lack this adequate combination of the dynamic duo. One of the two is missing. Run-on sentences therefore have coordinating conjunctions, but don't have the necessary comma that go alongside coordinating conjunctions, which combine two independent clauses. Knowing all of this, we can therefore add two different guidelines to our rules. Our third guideline, as we said, is that commas aren't strong enough to conjoin two independent clauses. Now, we've just learned a fourth guideline, which is that conjunctions are too strong. They're exceptionally strong, so they need to actually be paired with a comma, which can kind of tone them down a bit. It weakens them and dilutes it, such that you can avoid the problem of having a run-on sentence. We now have our four guidelines. Let's just recapitulate everything that we've said. The first two guidelines, as we've discussed, deal with ordering dependent and independent clauses. One has to go before the other. One is subordinate to the other. The latter two guidelines deal with coordination. They still deal with ordering clauses, but in this case, the coordination means that both of the clauses are equal. They're both independent clauses. Coordinated independent clauses, therefore, as we said, require a coordinating conjunction. So let's review the review now. If you have a dependent clause and then an independent clause, you have to put a comma between them. But if you flip them around and have an independent clause and then a dependent clause, you don't need a comma between the two of them. That's guidelines one and two. Now, remember that if we have an independent clause and another independent clause, we can't put a comma in between them. That's what's called a comma splice. This makes your English professor sad. It's not necessarily incorrect. There's actually a literary device that conjoins two independent clauses with a comma, but that's a subject for a different video. To avoid comma splices, you then have to put a comma and then add between the two independent clauses in your comma a coordinating conjunction in order to make equal the two independent clauses. Having a comma plus a coordinating conjunction obviously makes your English professor very happy. The final thing that we've learned is that coordinating conjunctions on their own are way too strong to join two independent clauses together. So you got to have something to dilute it. You have to have the other half of that dynamic duo in order to tone the conjunction down a little bit. If you don't have that comma and you've just stuck together two independent clauses and shoved in between them a coordinating conjunction, you have what's called a run-on sentence. And this obviously makes your English professor sad. So again, you want to make her happy, so do the comma plus your coordinating conjunction. If you'd like a little bit more practice learning to identify all of these different parts of sentences and then also how to avoid comma splices and run-on sentences and properly add coordinating conjunctions and all of that, I would encourage you to watch the forthcoming video on practice putting different clauses together. That's all for now. Bye.